Good morning.
Good morning.
It's good to see each and every one of you here this morning as we gather around God's Word and God's Sacrament, and it's also All Saints Day. So in our prayers, we're going to give thanks to God for the gift of eternal life given to those members who have died since this last year's All Saints Day. So hopefully we will have a chime following their names during our prayers. We begin our worship by singing For All the Saints.
Thank you.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Beloved in the Lord, let us draw near with a true heart to confess our sins unto God our Father, beseeching him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord.
Amen.
I said I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord. O Almighty God, merciful Father,
I, poor, miserable sinner, confess unto you all my sins and iniquities, with which I have wrought on you, and justly deserve the world and eternal punishment. But I have heard so sorry for them, and sincerely repent of them, and I pray for your boundless mercy, and for the sake of the holy, innocent, and pure sufferings of heaven, of your blessed Son, Jesus Christ. Be gracious and merciful to me, in poor sinful being.
Upon this your confession, I, by virtue of my office as a called and ordained servant of the word, announce the grace of God unto all of you, and in the stead and by the command of my Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
These are the ones coming out of the great tribulation.
They have washed up their robes, clean and white in the blood of the Lamb.
In you, O Lord, do I take refuge. Let me never be put to shame.
In your righteousness, deliver me.
For you are my rock and my fortress.
And when your name is saved, you lead me and guide me.
Into your hand I commit my spirit.
You have redeemed me, O Lord.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. These are the ones coming out of the great tribulation.
They have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb.
Almighty and everlasting God, You knit together your faithful people of all times and places into one holy communion, the mystical body of your Son, Jesus Christ. Grant us so to follow your blessed saints and all virtuous and godly women, that together with them we may come to the unspeakable joys you prepared for those who love you. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Our first reading for All Saints' Day comes to us from the 7th chapter of John's Revelation, verses 9 through 17. And it's a heavenly picture that John received. He sees a multitude of people he can't number from every nation gathered around the Lamb of God. They proclaim salvation belongs to our God and to the Lamb. It is a powerful picture of God gathering his people around him forever. We read, "After this I looked, and behold, a great multitude that no one could number, from every nation, from all tribes and peoples and languages, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed in white robes with palm branches in their hands, and crying out with a loud voice, 'Salvation belongs to our God, who sits on the throne and to the Lamb.' And all the angels were standing around the throne and around the elders and the four living creatures. And they fell on their faces before the throne and worshiped God, saying, 'Amen. Blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be to our God forever and ever. Amen.' Then one of the elders addressed me, saying, 'Who are these clothed in white robes, and from where have they come?' I said to him, 'Sir, you know.' And he said to me, 'These are the ones coming out of the great tribulation. They have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. Therefore they are before the throne of God and serve him day and night in his temple. And he who sits on the throne will shelter them with his presence. They shall hunger no more, neither thirst any more. The sun shall not strike them, nor any scorching heat. For the Lamb in the midst of the throne will be their shepherd, and he will guide them to springs of living water. And God will wipe away every tear from their eyes.'" This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our epistle reading comes to us from John's first epistle, chapter 3, the first three verses. And John reminds us that God's love is great. It's the most amazing thing ever, because God's love has made you his children. John writes, "See what kind of love the Father has given to us, that we should be called children of God. And so we are. The reason why the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Beloved, we are God's children now. And what we will be has not yet appeared, but we know that when he appears, we shall be like him, because we shall see him as he is. And everyone who thus hopes in him purifies himself, as he is pure." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand. The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 5th chapter. Which is known as the Beatitudes. Here is the beginning of Jesus' first sermon of his ministry, the Sermon on the Mount. And he begins his teaching by demonstrating that the way of a Christian and the way of Jesus is the opposite of what the world would expect. We read, "Seeing the crowds, he went up on the mountain, and when he sat down, his disciples came to him. And he opened his mouth and taught them, saying, 'Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be satisfied. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called sons of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when others revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven. For so they persecuted the prophets who were before you. This is the gospel of the Lord. We now confess our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed.
I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds.
We continue our worship by singing 743, Jesus, Priceless Treasure. Please be seated.
Thank you.
Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. When I was a sophomore in high school, I was invited to take part in a math meet at the University of Wisconsin Eau Claire campus. Now, this was the first time I had ever participated in a math meet, and I was a little nervous and very intimidated. Thankfully, I didn't have to answer any questions in front of a group of people. Instead, we had to take four tests. And if I remember correctly, the four tests were algebra, geometry, trigonometry, and calculus. Again, I was only a sophomore. I felt confident about the algebra test, but the rest were out of my league. I didn't learn any of that stuff on those last three tests. And I remember our teacher saying, if you don't know how to do a problem, you can always guess. And oftentimes there's going to be a question that the answer is 1 or negative 1. And if I remember correctly, the tests were worth 10 points. They had 4 questions, so it was 1 point, then 2 points, then 3 points, then 4 points. So 4 tests, 10 points, total 40 points is the best score you could get. And as confident as I felt about my algebra test, I just did okay, but not perfect. I can still remember that I made a really stupid mistake on one question. But then came the third test, the trigonometry test. And I'm reading these questions, I don't even understand the words that I'm reading, let alone understanding how to solve problems. So for one question, I guessed. I answered 1. For another question, I guessed again and answered -1. And you know what? I got them right. I correctly guessed 1 and -1 on the correct questions and got them right. I couldn't believe it. So at the end, when all the scores were added up, I scored 17 points out of 40. Now that doesn't sound so impressive, except I had the second highest score on our team. That's sophomores through seniors. And I can still remember the gleam in my math teacher's eye when he reported my score to me. He was so proud of me. But I got at least 7 of those points because I happened to guess correctly. The teacher thought of me more highly than I had ever deserved, and I had earned respect that I really didn't earn. Do you have a story like that? A story about how you received something that you didn't deserve, or praise for something that just was luck? Maybe it's a spouse. Why did he or she marry me? Maybe it's a child that's grown up, and despite all your mistakes, you were still able to say, well, I guess I must have done something right. Or maybe it's a promotion at work. I actually remember a guy telling me this almost word for word, that he goes to work each day expecting to get fired because he doesn't know what he's doing anymore. And every time they call him in the office, he thinks, this is it. This is my last day. But instead, they keep promoting him to a higher position to do more stuff that he doesn't really know or understand. I have a reminder of this every time I mow the lawn. 2 years ago, the members of Trinity bought us a riding lawnmower. And every time I start it up, there is the Trinity insignia printed on the hood with mine and my family's name on it. And I'm reminded that my Trinity family has loved me in a way that I never deserve and I could never earn. It's the same way with God's love for you. See what kind of love the Father has given to us, that we should be called children of God. And so we are. And I feel like the way we read this verse is the same reaction I have when I hop onto that lawnmower. See how God has loved you. Just as I am reminded by that painting on the hood of my mower. So every time we see a cross, we are reminded about how much God truly loves you. The cross shows you how far God's love will go for you. God literally loved you to death. And there's no way you could deserve that love. It's humanly impossible to have earned that kind of love from God. But the cross also reminds us of something else. That God's work isn't done. One of the interesting things about a lot of crosses is that they're empty crosses. And by empty cross, I mean it's a cross with no one on it, like the cross on our altar. And one of the nice things about an empty cross is that it reminds us something else about Jesus. It reminds us that Jesus didn't stay dead. He rose from the dead. God not only loved you to death, but he overcame death by rising from the dead. So when we see an empty cross, we can say it's empty because Jesus' tomb is empty. And that becomes very important to us because eventually those things start to catch up to us. Go back to my math meet days. My teacher was so proud I got a 17 at my first math meet. Fast forward to 2 years later. It's my third math meet. I'm now a senior in high school. I'm in calculus. I've had algebra, geometry, and trigonometry. I should be ready to go. But again, those tests were still hard. Hard enough that I remember all 3 years, no one ever got a perfect score. If I remember correctly, the highest score was probably a 36 out of 40. And to be honest, I still didn't understand some of the questions. And this year, 1 and negative 1 were nowhere to be found for a single answer on the test. And so they announced the winners and we start to head home. And that same math teacher was so proud of me as a sophomore, asked me, well, what was your final score? And I looked at our team's score sheet and I said, I got a 17. The exact same score I'd gotten 2 years before. It was still one of the highest scores for our team. But his disappointment was palpable. Same score as a sophomore. But this year I thought I knew what I was doing. And yet I couldn't have done any better than my first year. And I was revealed to that teacher. It became clear that I was a math meet fraud and there was nothing that I could do now to change that reality. This is what often happens in this world. Eventually, the truth comes out. You didn't deserve that promotion and it catches up with you. Your spouse finds out who you truly are and is disappointed or even disgusted. Your child becomes an adult and realizes the many mistakes you did make. Reality catches up with you, and you can't always hide your deficiencies or shortcomings anymore, and you begin to look like a fraud. And the scary thing is, what if God thinks of us in the same way? Oh yeah, God became human to die on the cross for you, but now that he really knows you, could he rethink this whole eternity with you? And yet nothing could be further from the truth. As we turn again to that empty cross, we're reminded that Jesus rose from the dead, and one day he will return and bring you into perfect paradise forever. As John writes, beloved children, beloved, we are God's children now. And what we will be has not yet appeared. But when he appears, we shall be like him. We shall be resurrected, defeating death, living forever. What exactly does that look like? What does that feel like? We aren't sure because it hasn't been revealed But because of Jesus, we have a future eternity waiting for you that won't be taken away. The truth is, in the path of justice, we may act with humility and honor for the good of all people. Give wisdom to all who vote, and bless its result that our nation may elect our leaders peacefully and orderly. Lord, in your mercy, mighty and eternal God, we rejoice that you have rescued us from the power of death and raised us in Christ to dwell with him in everlasting life. Give to those who grieve the comfort of the promise of the resurrection of the dead and eternal life, and bestow your peace upon the dying, that they may fall asleep here and awaken in your glory. Lord, in your mercy, mighty and eternal God, you have made us your children, and you continue to guard us as your own possession. According to your will, give healing to the sick, calm to the troubled in mind, an end to the pandemic, and patience to those facing sorrow and struggle. Hear us especially on behalf of Tim, Myron, Larry, Marlene, Helen, Karen, Helen, Doris, Jerry, John, and Joel. Lord, in your mercy, mighty and eternal God, show forth your kindness to the poor and your compassion to those who suffer injustice. Deliver us from the scourge of racism and prejudice, and help us to acknowledge our common life from your creative power and our common redemption in Christ, our Savior. Lord, in your mercy. Mighty and eternal God, we are unworthy of all your blessings. We do not deserve the mercies new every morning of our earthly lives. Give us the will and desire to care responsibly for all that you have entrusted to us, to be generous with those in need, for the support of Trinity Lutheran Church and School. Lord, in your mercy. Mighty and eternal God, bring us to that day when every tear shall be wiped away from our eyes, and we shall hunger and thirst no more. Knowing you now by faith, we yearn for the day when we shall know you face to face. Until the dawn of that eternal day, keep us in your faith and fear through our good shepherd and Lord, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks unto the Lord our God. Salutary, we should all times and all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God. In the communion of all your saints, gathered in the one body of your Son, you have surrounded us with so great a cloud of witnesses that we, encouraged by their faith and strengthened by their fellowship, may run with perseverance the race that is set before us, and together with them receive the crown of glory that does not fade away. Therefore, with angels and archangels, with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying,
thank you. betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way also he took the cup after supper. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Thank you.
We continue with the Nunc Dimittis. Please stand. Unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. And we remain standing for our closing hymn, 744, Amazing Grace.
Thank you.
good to see each and every one of you here this morning as we gather around God's Word and God's Sacrament on this All Saints Day. And it's also the first Sunday of the month, so that means it's Birthday Sunday. Right, Alice?
Right.
And so they have treats on the table for you in bags that you can take and eat. And so who here has a birthday in November? Stand up nice and tall. All right.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear everyone. Happy birthday to you. God's blessings to you. God's blessings to you.
Any other announcements? None? Then let's conclude the Bible verse of the month. As for you, brothers, do not grow weary in doing good. God's blessings to you this week.